Greetings, movie lovers! If you don't know me, my name is Old School! The 1982 schlocktastic giant monster madness movie that is Q, the Winged Serpent. I absolutely love this movie. What's not to love? I'm true Gen X, man. I love me all the early 80s mashup horror comedy monster cop movies that existed, man. This one especially, dude. Q, the Winged Serpent, released in 1982, directed by schlock-auteur Larry Cohen, who also directed another 80s schlocktastic classic, The Stuff. And this movie stars one of my favorite 80s genre actors, Michael Moriarty, who you might know from Troll 1 as playing Harry Potter, and you might also know from Larry Cohen's other film that I just mentioned, The Stuff. And the other star of this movie, none other than the Kung Fu Master himself, David Carradine, dude, as Detective Shepard. Now let me just say real quick, man, dude, the on-screen chemistry between David Carradine and Michael Moriarty, dude, it's palpable. There is so much fun tension and back and forth because Moriarty plays the, you know, down on his luck, shitbag criminal. And of course, Carradine is like the, you know, hard as nails on the job New York cop, dude. So their dynamic right there, aside from the fact that there's a giant Aztec winged monster flying around, dude, killing people and shit like that, dude. There are so many reasons to watch this movie, I'm getting ahead of myself, dude. So, the film also stars Shaft himself, Richard Roundtree, in a subsequent role as another cop. And Moriarty's girlfriend, dude, is played by Candy Clark, who you might know from a little film George Lucas role called American Graffiti, dude. What a cast. It's hard to think about this movie without thinking about another schlocktastic early 80s film I love, Chud. But we'll get there. We will get to Chud. Other people have reviewed it, but I've never reviewed it. My phone just went off. So let's actually talk about this movie and give an overview of its story. This film takes place in New York City in the early 80s. Immediately, right off the bat, dude, there's a window washer on a skyscraper. He's cleaning up the windows and stuff like that. Boom! Q rolls up, rips the motherfucker's head clean off his neck, dude. Flies away, body parts start hitting the streets. When the body parts start hitting the streets, the cops are alerted because there's like heads and hands, like in the gutters everywhere. So David Carradine shows up to be like, what the hell's going on? Now, immediately following that, we are introduced to Michael Moriarty as Jimmy Quinn. Quinn, like I said, a down-on-his-luck gangster, driver for, like, diamond heists and stuff like that. But what he really wants to be is a jazz pianist, man. He wants to play the keys in, like, the local hipster New York bars and shit, man. So bizarre, dude. Now, when I say Moriarty makes his film, I am not exaggerating. There is an entire bar sequence, man, where he, like, improvs some crazy, like, fusion acid jazz trying to get a job because he don't want to be, like, a gangster criminal no more, dude. It is just completely off-center and out of left field. And the best thing, I swear about Michael Moriarty in this movie, dude, he is like if Bill Burr's career was actually happening in the early 80s, and instead of being born in Massachusetts, Burr was born in New York, because I swear to God, Bill Burr and Michael Moriarty are like distant cousins, or the same person, or they're related. If there was a remake of Q, you'd have to hire Bill Burr to play Jimmy Quinn. You'd have to, hands down. So the point is, right, the two stories of the cops looking for whatever the fuck is killing all these people and fucking Jimmy Quinn's fucking quest for, like, validation in his life because he's a complete fucking loser and he knows it, dude. They come to a head, dude, when Quinn is on the run, so he goes to hide in the Chrysler Building. I mean, there's a series of events here, but he winds up at the top of the Chrysler Building, man, right? And up there, he discovers Q's nest, right? And the guys who were chasing them in that scene, dude, get eaten by Q. And he's like, ah, I have a place where I can bring people to kill them because there's a giant winged demon in this building. I hope this is making some type of sense, because I don't really want to give away every single thing in the movie and do, like, a, you know, beat for beat review of this movie, because I want you to watch it. The whole reason why we're talking about this film is the fact that this needs to be a yearly watch. You can watch it anytime. It should be in rotation with all the other classic monster movies and horror movies that exist. Now, also going on this whole time, which I forgot to mention, dude, is Detective Shepard, Carradine. He has been, like, searching for the killer in a bunch of ritual sacrifice homicides, dude, which I don't know if this is going to give anything away or not, dude, but these sacrifices are the things, these Aztec sacrifices, are the thing that woke up Q in the first place on purpose to cleanse humanity. It's like one of those things, you know what I mean? It's like, bring back the giant winged deity god to wipe the planet clean. Q is like flying around, killing like people in like swimming pools and rooftops all over New York City. So anyway, dude, Quinn is at the police station, overhears Shepard talking about Q and these murders and everything going on like that. And of course, Quinn knows exactly where Q is. He's like his friend. He's like trying to use him and shit. Crunch, crunch. He's just like loving it. When like he's like insane. This movie is fucking insane, dude. It eventually turns out that Quinn tells the cops where Q is, but it was like $1 million and like the book rates and like the photo rates. And he's like, my ship has come in, right? It's like, I am gonna make it now, dude. And everyone's like, dude, you knew about where Q was for like days, and then like 10 people died in the meantime. Everything culminates in this movie on a all-out attack on the top of the Chrysler Building, man. And this is the number one thing. So that's the gist of the movie. You got the point. It's like monsters and cops and crazy shit, right? So reasons why this movie stands out. We're gonna jump to the end here. Reasons why this movie stands out. Number one, it's not the fact that the cheesy special effects are awesome. It's not the fact that there's overacting in it. It's not the fact that it's a beautiful time capsule that actually holds it better than some movies today because of its brisk pacing. It's the aerial camera work and the cinematography done on a budget of what I believe now, I'm not 100% sure if this is 100% accurate, was $300,000 they made this movie. Which seems like even a little low for 1982 standards, man. The aerial shots, the crane work, the top of the skyscrapers, the sweeping street views, everything about it, dude. And then, of course, there are the legitimate laugh out loud, ridiculous stop motion animation moments where Q himself is chewing people up. It is amazing. It is hysterical. It's throwback, and it's something that I really miss. 5 stars out of 5 stars for me, man. I can't get enough of this movie. I watched it 3 times this year already, man. So check out Q, the Winged Serpent, dude. My name is Old School.